He said, I sought knowledge and I was able to gain some. But I tried to find adab and to learn it and I found that its people had passed away. The basmala, alhamdala, rububiya, al-jihad, tawba, fada'il al-a'mal, al-salah, tarbiya, al-saghair, wal-kabair. That he loved Khadija so much, that he was so fond of her, is that the continual mentioning of her name, you know. And so, if you see people keep mentioning someone, then you know let that be an indication to you of what's going on. Because when someone keeps mentioning someone, talking about them all the time, they know that something is a bit special there, huh? If some of your mates are starting talking about a few things, then you know, because Ibn Hajar said this is a sign of someone whose love is now taking over his senses. And you know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had good reason to love Khadija so much. The first person, or from the very, very first people who believed, to believe in him, to support him, to comfort him, to protect him at his immense time of weakness, the mother of his children, and these children who gave us Ahlul Bayt, yani gave us the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the mother of Fatima, okay, and Kalthum, and yani this Khadija, she has a maqam that no wonder that the other wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were so jealous about, that despite his love for them, she was his favorite. And we know that this favoritism per se is not permissible when you treat someone in a favorable way. Okay, for example, we know that when you're married to more than one wife and you start to treat them differently, this is haram. But if you love one more than the other, because this is just the way, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. He hasn't burdened a soul more than it can bear. And he definitely hasn't burdened the hearts more than what they can bear. And if they love someone more than the other, what can the hearts do? What can the hearts do? So Aisha radiallahu anha, well known that she was jealous of this in the best way, not any meaning harm for her. That's another clarification which is important. To be jealous is of different types. Okay, to be jealous of someone, to really admire them and wish that you was like them in that aspect or that idea or that quality or that sifa or characteristic. This is what we're talking about. But when you start to say that I wish that they lost it, or I wish that this would happen to them or that would happen to them, this is haram. And this is when it really takes control, and then it leads you to the haram, as it did this person. So what was a natural love and a good love and an honest love, he's seen a woman that he loved, beautiful woman, loves the woman, and you know, he went around the right way and he was rejected. And instead of taking the rejection, he lost it and he killed her. Okay? This is what happens when the jealousy loses control, or when you cannot control your emotions as much as you should. So another indication, of course, that it shows is that how important marriage is, and how deadly the relationship between man and woman can be, even when it's not even being developed. That's why Islam, as we know, is so specific in trying to cut off all the paths to increasing interaction between men and women. Because often, this kind of reaction would happen if someone was married, right? Okay, and you see your wife do something like that, then that is the obvious scenario where you kill someone who has got involved with your wife, for example. But here is a situation where they're not even engaged, they're not even about to get married. He's just looking to get married to her. And you can see that even at this stage, so low down in the relationship scale, the love can be so strong that it causes another person to become so jealous so that he kills because of it. Okay? But what's different in Islam, again, against the popular understanding of people, is that Islam tries to understand this situation and tries to give the training to the heart to deal with it. And not to suddenly, as we see in our society today, these kind of draconian measures where the response to this reality, the reality of love, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed between the people, this feeling of affection between man and woman is something purely natural. Okay, and that's why when Allah Subhanahu wa Taala says in the Quran, "ومن آياتنا خلق لكم أنفسكم أزواجا لتسكنوا إليها," when Allah Subhanahu wa Taala has created from you amongst you partners so that you may live to them, وجعل بينكم مودة ورحمة, and placed between you, يعني this رحمة and this deep love. إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يتفكرون. يعني in this, in all of these yani things that you see and these emotions and these relationships that you see that are developing amongst you and around you, you see in these yani signs, in these kind of rulings, in these principles, in these concepts, are a sign for a people who think deeply, who think deeply, not just react with emotion and rule in silly ways and so on, but look at this situation and think about it and try to develop policy and to develop strategy for the society and the community to deal with these issues in a proper way. So we see that once it goes out of control, this is what happens. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he's approached, the man puts his scenario to him, and so he deals with it in a way where he understands that the most serious of crimes are killing someone, and it is a serious crime. In fact, it is narrated from Ibn Abbas in his earlier days, okay, and many, many Sahaba, that even other than shirk being the sin that has no forgiveness, that leads to a person being in the fire forever, likewise killing a person is like that. But this narration proves that it's only the action of shirk that leads a person into the hellfire forever with no forgiveness. Okay. Whereas for killing a person, if one is able to repay the diya, to give the diya, and then seek tawbah and istighfar, and we'll come to that in the next session because we don't have much time now to deal with tawbah and istighfar, which is the key element to this hadith, then we know that there is forgiveness available for this action. And that's why Ibn Abbas even entertained this person, because if it wasn't the case, then there would be no entertaining telling him now that you make tawbah and so on and so on, because you can't make tawbah from a sin which is impossible to. So he did, and he told him that this is how, and what was it, and we end with this because of the time. What did he say? He said, "Yani, is your mother alive?" Because, and when we find out afterwards, why did he ask that question? Because he said that, "I do not know of any good actions or anything as good as being good to your mother." I.e. he's talking about, he's making a constructive plan, and this is what we're going to look at in detail in the next session, a constructive plan, a plan of action for this person to get himself out of the problem that he is. And that's the mark of a faqih, of a scholar. The mark of a scholar, not to tell people what, this is haram, this is halal, but he's there to give solutions to the people, to bring ease to the community and society. He's there to be a light for them and a rahmah for them, and not someone who just tells them this is right, this is wrong. Wallahu a'lam. Inshallah, we'll deal with the rest of this hadith in the next session. Wa barakallahu fiqh, wa subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illa ant, wa astaghfirukallahumma, wa atubu ilayk. Ooh. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا، وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك يا رب العالمين، آمين. Not only is, as we just seen here, these are intrinsic parts of the istighfar and the feeling and the fact that you won't go back to the sin. That's obviously one part. So you've just done one thing. But now, we've seriously decreased our good deeds here. And we've got a serious stack of bad deeds that need to be taken care of. So the tawbah, inshallah, that's mukhlis and sincere, will wipe that out. But what about the other side? And that's why now, we need to now concentrate on that. Taqarrub. Okay, that's why then Ibn Abbas says, yani, that he suggests the issue of the mother being good to her. Because now it's time to start gathering good deeds and quick. Okay, because now it's time to get closer to Allah. And that's why when he says, in that he says to the person when he came, Tub ila Allah Azza wa Jal, repent to Allah Azza wa Jal. Wa taqarrab ilayhi mastata'at. Get closer to him as much as you can. And this is yani something, it's an established principle in the Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the believers that in al-hasanat yudhibna as-sayyi'at, that the good deeds, they efface, they take away the bad deeds. Okay? وَذَٰلِكَ ذِكْرَ لِلذَّاكِرِينَ. And that yani is a reminder for those who take reminders on board, those who remember, those who think, those who constantly are auditing themselves. That if they remember this fact, that those who do good deeds, in al-hasanat yudhibna as-sayyi'at, the good deeds, alright, hasanat yudhibna as-sayyi'at, they take away the bad deeds, not just by cancelling them out, but by building up the good deeds as well. And if you look at the beginning of the ayah, وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ طَرَفَيِ النَّهَارَ وَزُلَفًا مِنَ اللَّيْلِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala almost yani gives the answer there, and perform the salah at the two ends of the days and in some hours of the night. Showing yani that here is an option in the morning and then in the evening to try and get rid of the problems that you're having in the day. Build up some credit. And this is the system, because you know what's really important for the Muslims is that when they make a mistake, and this is really evident in this person. Imagine that you were this person who's just yani totally without reason or any just cause just going to kill someone. And you know as a Muslim, a Sahabi, living at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, that the Quran has just been revealed. And you have known and you can see that the one who takes another person's life is destined for the hellfire. Can you imagine? Yani, and oh, we're talking a muttaqi, we're talking people who fear Allah. Can you imagine the mindset of that person? Can you imagine how broken that person would be? I mean, just put yourself in that scenario of an accidental death. Forget about yani murdering someone. I mean, you know, we all have good opinions of each other, especially the Muslims. But is anyone here? I mean, hundreds of you. I mean, could you imagine killing someone? Could you just imagine that? What about just accidentally? Forget about intentionally go out to murder someone. How would you just deal with it? How would you have to sleep at night? How would you? That's just from a social level. Then what about someone who's close to Allah? What about someone who recognizes the seriousness of that with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Yet this person came. You know why? Because it is haram to despair from the mercy of Allah. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَتُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Do not despair. Those who... قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا. Say, yani, it's a command. O you who have done this transgression against your own selves. Because that's what sin is, of course. Sin and yani these actions yani of evil, you're not affecting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're not changing the world system or the order. You'll go and more people will come and they will go and more people will come. The only person you're affecting is your own self. You've only done zulm against your own self. Your soul deserves much more than that. But you've done zulm against it. You've been the one who's transgressed against it. Lakin, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا تَقْنَتُ مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Do not despair of the mercy of Allah. Because why? إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرِ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all sins. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives them all. This is yani Allahu Akbar. Yani, is this not the greatest ayah in the Quran that a man can ever read? That when he hears this one, that yani despite whatever you do, know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He forgives all sins. إنه يعني and who? What is he? After يعني he has told us that he is the one who forgives all the sins. الغفور الرحيم. The one who is all forgiving, most merciful. This is our Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the difference between the way that we live our lives and the other people who live in a system of sin and evil and transgression, and they have no idea where to turn. And out of the desperation then, because every single person knows, you don't have to be Muslim per se to recognize that when you do dhulm against yourself, when you do evil,